From before recorded time, the first peoples of the Ngunnawal and Ngambri nations cared for this land. We praise the Creator for the beauty of this land and honour those who have cared for it. We acknowledge the elders and community members who have told the sacred stories and nurtured faithfulness to the Creator. We ask God's blessing on those who continue to work for the healing and restoration of this land and her communities. We light this candle as a sign of God's Spirit at work in the world.
May its light brighten our spirits. May the light of God shining through us brighten the world.
Our call to worship. We are here.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
To worship the God who gives us life and sustains it.
And to praise the Spirit who enlightens us.
Great is our God and deserves our greatest praise.
God is awesome beyond all our imagining.
Each generation shall pass on the good news to the next.
And shall publicly celebrate God's saving actions.
Please keep yourself muted, but join in as we sing our first song. The song is God is Love, Let Heaven Adore Him. Worshipping with us today. My name is Irene Lund and I am part of the Western Creek Uniting Congregation with links to some in the Woden Valley Congregation. An especially warm welcome to those who are worshipping with us for the first time or who have returned after an absence. Your presence both enriches us and this time of celebration together. Please stay muted unless asked otherwise. Our opening prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have been the dwelling place of your people in all generations. Your mercies are more than we can number, and your compassion is without end. God, we need never call for your presence with us. You have been with us and in us and around us since before the creation of the world. Today we seek not your presence, but our awareness of that presence, knowing that you long for us to know you as we are known by you. Grant us now the help of the Holy Spirit, that we may praise you for your goodness and mercy, receive your word with joy and thanksgiving, and give ourselves again to you in love and service, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now, as we pass the peace to each other, I invite you to switch to gallery view and unmute as we greet each other. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us share signs of peace with one another.
Peace be with you all.
Peace be with you.
Hello.
Everybody.
Please now mute yourself again as we join in the hymn, Be Still for the Presence of the Lord. Some readings of lament from Psalm 22 and also from the book of Job. Brendan will be leading us in the singing of the psalm, and Marilyn will be reading the passage from Job. Following that, we will join in a prayer of lament before Marilyn reads a passage from Hebrews.
So this is your response.
My God, my God, why have you abandoned me?
Sing together.
My God, my God, why have you abandoned me?
They curl their lips, they toss their heads. He trusted in the Lord. Let God save him and come to free him. If this is God's friend. my God, why have you abandoned me? They divide my clothes among them. They cast lots for my robe. Oh Lord, do not leave me alone. My strength make haste to my God, why have you abandoned me? I will tell your name to my people and praise you where they gather. All you who fear the Lord, sing your praises. All tribes of Jacob, give your glory. My God, why have you abandoned me?
I am going to read from Job verses 1 to 9 and 16 to 17. Then Job answered, "Today also my complaint is bitter. My hand is heavy despite my groaning. Oh, that I knew where I might find him, that I might even come to this dwelling. I would lay my case before him and fill my mouth with arguments. I would learn what he would answer me and understand what he would say to me. Would he contend with me in the greatness of his power? No, but he would give heed to me. There is an upright person could reason with him. And if I should acquit forever by my judge, if I go forward, he is not there. If I go backward, I cannot perceive him. On the left, he hides, and I cannot behold him. I turn to the right, but I cannot see him. God has made my heart faint. The Almighty has terrified me. If only I could vanish in darkness, and thick darkness would cover my face."
A prayer of lament. O Lord, how long shall we cry for help and you will not listen? Or cry to you, violence, and you will not save? Why do you make us see wrongdoing and look at trouble? In faith and hope we respond.
How long, O God? How long?
O God, you have rejected us, broken our defences. You have been angry with us. Now restore us. How long, O people? How long?
How long, O God? How long?
Where is your justice, God?
Where is your purpose? Where is your reason?
Where is your compassion? Do you not care for your people, your creation, your reputation?
Your purpose is hidden from our eyes. Your reason is absent from our ears. Your compassion is not discerned by our hearts. We have no hope. We are lost. We are afraid.
In faith, we appeal to God. In hope, we will not let God go. In love, we claim God's attention. Let us honour the God who receives our cries and gathers us to herself even as we continue to call. We praise you, O God.
In your humility, you seek us. In your mercy, you keep us. In your humiliation, you glorify us. In your generosity, you provide for us. In your wisdom, you place us. In your might, you shield us. In your governance, you make us holy. In your communion, you teach us. In your love, you lift us up. Amen.
Our second reading is from Hebrews 4, verses 12 to 16. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart, and before him no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we can receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. These are the words of God.
I have a sister who is widowed and lives alone in Sydney. We talk on the phone every few days, and occasionally one of us will start the conversation by saying, "Can I have a whinge?" So one of us will talk about the irritating neighbour, or our urgent need for a haircut, or the inquiring phone call where we couldn't speak with a human and the options given did not include what we wanted to ask. And so it goes on. Then after we've had our whinge, we have a little laugh together and all is well. One friend says there is a definite need for a grumble line in the same vein as Lifeline, but for trivial matters. However, for quite a long time after her husband died, my sister would say during the course of a phone call that she felt so lonely and down, and I would hear the tears. The month of October is designated as Mental Health Month, and today, October 10, it is World Mental Health Day. Many, many people in Australia and around the world live with mental health issues, and the advent of the pandemic has added to these either directly or indirectly. There are so many lonely people under lockdown conditions. I volunteer at Meranjani Nursing Home, and I've continued to attend as an essential worker, although a volunteer, during the lockdown period. Meranjani in general is a cheerful place, but when you talk individually to residents, I often hear, "Why am I here? I miss my family. I miss my home." And that is from those who are able to verbalise these things. For those outside the nursing home, many are under the stress of working from home as well as trying to supervise remote learning with their children. There are others who are feeling financial strain from their workplace being in limbo, those unable to see precious grandchildren, and those mourning the untimely death of a loved one and unable to be with family even for the funeral. All these situations and more can affect mental health, and often resources to manage this are stretched to the limit with months-long waiting lists for help. Even now that we can see the easing of restrictions beginning to occur, the effects will last for a long time. This morning we've heard a few laments. We may tend to think of the Psalms as positive and full of praise. One of my favourites is Psalm 8. O Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. And then again I think of Psalm 98. O sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvellous things. However, as we've seen this morning, the Psalms also include those of lament, including Psalm 22. The psalmist is suffering at the hands of evil men, yet his greatest pain is not physical, but bewilderment. Why doesn't the God of Israel, the God who saved Israel from slavery in Egypt, now save this servant of his, a servant God has always looked out for, even from birth? And God, who is supposed to guarantee the ultimate meaningfulness of things, presents as one strangely absent or indifferent. My God, why have you forsaken me? I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but find no rest. The reading from Job is not very different. It is a story of a prosperous man who is righteous before Yahweh, even to the point where God boasts about him before a gathering of the heavenly powers. One of the gathering, an accuser, approaches Yahweh to ask if Job would really be quite so virtuous if he lost God's obvious favour and protection. The accuser says, "Does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not put a fence around him and his house and all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But stretch out your hand now and touch all that he has, and he will curse you to your face." Yahweh's response is to grant the accuser power to destroy the man's possessions, his health, and even his family, but not his life. At first, Job righteously refuses to question God's purposes in any of this, but very soon, as the injustice of it all seeps into his being, Job's resolve falters. In all the words that flow from Job's lips after this, in all the lament and heartache, it seems that Job is searching for one thing and one thing only, the opportunity to wrest from God a convincing explanation for his suffering. But that explanation, as much as God himself, eludes Job to the very end. Searching for his elusive God, Job says, "Oh, that I knew where to find him. I would lay my case before him and fill my mouth with arguments. I would learn what he would answer me and understand what he would say to me. There an upright person could reason with God, and I would be acquitted forever by my judge." Like the psalmist, Job's suffering, loss, and shame are terrible enough, but what distresses him even more is the fact that his God, the God who Job has put his trust in all his life, refuses to present himself. Job says, "If I go forward, he is not there, or backward, I cannot perceive him. On the left, he hides, and I cannot behold him. I turn to the right, but I cannot see him." We joined in a prayer of lament earlier. We used a different lament in the service a few weeks ago called "For the Sake of the Planet." Many of us will lament at different times in our lives. Many are lamenting at the present time. It is not unchristian or unbiblical to lament, to let God know that we feel abandoned or alone or depressed. Even Jesus would say while on the cross, my God, why have you abandoned me?" Quoting from Psalm 22. But we can move on from lament. Psalm 30 verse 5 says that weeping may linger for the night, but joy comes with the morning. And the lament we use today includes an affirmation of hope in Christ. In faith, we appeal to God. In hope, we will not let God go. In love, we claim God's attention. Let us honour the God who receives our cries and gathers us to herself even as we continue to call. And our reading from Hebrews tells us why we can hope. Most of us know the beginning verses of the Gospel of John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And a few verses later, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. The Hebrews reading tells us that the Word of God continues living and active, present tense, not something just in the past. What is the implication of that? I often look at The Message by Eugene Peterson, which is billed as the Bible in contemporary language, to hear a passage put another way. For this one, The Message says, God means what he says. What he says goes. His powerful word is sharp as a surgeon's scalpel, cutting through everything, whether doubt or defence, laying us open to listen and obey. Nothing and no one is impervious to God's word. We can't get away from it, no matter what. And another translation says that God's word faces us towards God as our heart recognizes the one for whom we yearn and for whom we are made. The NRSV, the version that was read this morning, talks about the word discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. While the psalmist and Job and even Jesus felt abandoned by God at certain points in their lives, and some of us may have had moments where we have felt that God is hidden from us, these various versions of Hebrews are telling us that we are not hidden from God at any time. God can always see us. And God can discern our inner thoughts and intentions. Oh dear, we can feel bereft when we feel abandoned by God, but knowing God can see into our hearts can be equally as scary. Do we live with fears about being found out? About people really seeing all of us, warts and all? None of us would want our ears to suddenly turn into loudspeakers and start broadcasting our every thought and desire to everyone around us. But God doesn't only see the things we are ashamed of and would like to keep hidden. God also sees the moments of torment and loneliness and the moments of joy and delight. Here in the next few verses of Hebrews is the affirmation of hope in Christ, which we can hang on to in dark times and times of doubt, the hope which can keep us keeping on. We are told that Jesus, the Son of God, is our great high priest. A Jewish audience would be completely comfortable with this talk of a great high priest because they were familiar with the ritual need of a sin bearer. Once a year, the high priest entered the Holy of Holies in the Jerusalem temple to perform a sacrifice of blood which was sprinkled on the mercy seat, God's throne, and would bring forgiveness to God's people. But Hebrews tells us that our great high priest lives forever, and our great high priest does not enter the Holy of Holies only once a year. Jesus Christ is sitting at the right hand of God all the time, and so has ready access to God all the time. Jesus, in his humanity, understood the common people, being one of them, and he went through everything that humans do, all the joys, all the sorrows, all the tensions, the temptations, the depths of despair, and the suffering. But as we are reminded, Jesus went through all of this without sinning. Jesus will rejoice with us in our moments of joy and delight. But he won't be horrified at seeing in our hearts those things we are ashamed of or those moments of torment and loneliness. He may be saddened when we fall into temptation and more saddened when we despair, but he won't turn away in disgust. but will embrace us with his love. Jesus is able to sympathize with our weaknesses. He has empathy for those who feel lost and abandoned. He understands what we go through because he has been there, and this is part of the hope. As our mediator, he continues to give himself to us in love, to encourage us to approach the throne of grace with boldness, seeking the mercy we need. Grace, the undeserved gift from God. Compassion and kindness, grace and mercy are there when we face our times of failure, when we face hard times and feelings of being alone and lonely, and when we're confronted with temptations which threaten to overwhelm us. As the message says, take the mercy, accept the help. And having accepted the help, God's grace and mercy, let us, as people of God, become God's agents to others, particularly in this Mental Health Month. Just as God reaches out to us, let us reach out and support those who suffer in silence. Let us pay attention, listen carefully without judgment, quietly empathizing just as Jesus does, and offer help and support, choosing to be workers of God in our community. God is there for each one of us, even when we doubt or are in mental distress. God sees us even when we can't see God. God understands our human situation, and the way to God is always open. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Amen.
If you would have a joy or a concern that you would like to share with the congregation, would you please wait a few seconds before speaking to help ensure that the line is clear and no one else is already speaking, to avoid more than one person coming in at once. And please remember to unmute yourself before speaking and to mute yourself when you have finished. Thank you.
This is George and Joan Pratt. Our step-granddaughter has just been diagnosed with COVID in Melbourne. And she lives with our daughter and son-in-law and their two small children, aged 9 and 7. So our step-granddaughter she's not feeling well. She's got flu symptoms, and she's had one vaccination. The other adults are both fully vaccinated, but of course the kids aren't. So they're quarantined for 14 days. And they've had one test and they're all negative. So they're very much in our prayers. Thanks.
Thank you. Let us pray. Heavenly Lord, we thank you for the blessings that you have bestowed on all your people. As we observe and enjoy the effective rebirth of many animals and plants after the hibernation and dormancy of winter, we are reminded of the miracle of your creation. We are also reminded of our responsibilities as stewards of your creation, a duty that many of us around the world, and particularly in the developed world, are not performing well. Let the light of the care candle shine in our sight and strengthen our awareness of your requirements of us, and out of need of your power to enable us to live our lives as Jesus Christ taught us during his earthly ministry. Along with our thanks, we bring before you our concerns about many things happening and many things not happening in both Australia and the wider world. In the developed world, we see the growing power of big money over governments at all levels, leading them to abrogate their social responsibilities and concentrate on fiscal aggregates. Among the results of these priorities, we see growing homelessness, increasing instances of suicide, growing inequality in the distribution of wealth between the rich and the bulk of the population, as pressures on government to adopt policies favouring the powerful. Economic pressures on families is leading to many instances of domestic violence as breadwinners sink towards despair as their wages and salary income do not keep up with movements in prices, and they have no idea how their families will manage to keep food on the table, clothing on their backs, or shelter over their heads. We hear reports of breadwinners facing decisions between feeding their children today and paying their next rent or mortgage instalment. To quote, rub salt into their wounds, unquote, they observe the super rich enjoying 10-minute joyrides in space at a cost of millions of dollars. Throughout the third and fourth worlds, we see the threat of full-scale famine due to natural disaster or warfare becoming unavoidable. Refugees, including many children, are incarcerated in camps, living with the risk of death in appalling conditions and with no end to their plight in sight. The Earth itself is facing potentially catastrophic danger from climate change, regardless of the degree of human activity as its source. We pray that our national government discards its blinkers and recognises the need for Australia to take remedial action to replace fossil fuel power with clean renewable power resources with which Australia is liberally endowed. Lord, we pray for people working while exposed to COVID virus and ask for your protection for these people as they face the hazard of every day. We pray also for those who have been infected and are fighting to regain their health. We pray also for others affected, particularly small business owners, facing total losses of everything they have worked for and built up over the years. These things we ask. We pray for church members who are ill or recovering from illness. We ask that you bless them and grant them a rapid and complete recovery. We ask your blessing for those who of our number suffering from other stresses and request that these afflictions be rapidly relieved. In the name of Jesus Christ, this is our prayer.
We bring our offerings before God. Let us pray. Loving God, who hears the cries of all your people and who proclaims each and every one of us to be of great worth, take these gifts we offer, the gifts of our time, our talents, our energy, our lives. May our giving help your church to proclaim the gospel of justice and truth throughout the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Please remain on mute, but join in as we sing our final song, Oh, let the Son of God enfold you.
Oh, let the Son of God enfold you with his Spirit and his love. Let him fill your heart and satisfy your soul. Oh, let him have the things that hold you, and his Spirit like a dove will descend upon your life. with gladness, as your hearts are filled with joy. Lift your hands in sweet surrender to his name. Oh, give him all your tears and sadness, give him all your years of pain, and you'll enter into life in Jesus' name. Jesus, oh Jesus, come and fill our lives. Jesus, oh Jesus, come and fill our lives.
Go boldly into the future which God has claimed. Know that the God who holds all things will be there, that Christ who calls us friend will walk beside us, and that the Spirit who makes all things new will mark our way with light and hope. Go in peace. Amen.